Ram Kumar, who in his own style has shared the questions which we have shared in the groups. And we normally keep on talking about the wills, but as to whether there are different types of wills, because normally as a common man, we always speak of will. And with the wills, like when Justice Ram Kumar and we had narrowed down the topic on the wills, and I sent him a message. He said that the will should be with a capital W. I said, so that W will always be there, because they say once there is a will, there is a lot of will to of the people to support that person who has got a will. So that was all in the lighter vein. And the essentials for a valid execution of an unprivileged will. As the today's session, and Justice V. Ram Kumar, we were always taking sessions which were touching on the criminal aspects. We all know that Justice Ram Kumar, in his subtle manner of, in a civilized manner of expressing the questions in the right manner, we requested him to take a certain session on the civil side, and again in the lighter vein, he said, yes, the colors of this civilized aspect should also come forth. And we all respect his knowledge and his way of expressions. And before we take the questions which we have shared today, fortuitously, we don't have our regular participants like Mr. Rao and Mr. Prem. So the questions will be shared with between me and Mr. Shyam. So as usual, I will request Mr. Shyam to just give a brief introduction, and then I will take the first question.
Thank you, Vikas. It's really a privilege to be back on this platform again, and that too with Justice Ram Kumar sir taking the session. To put it on the lighter vein, the question for today, if I can borrow Shakespeare, is to die willingly or unwillingly. So we are dealing with testamentary succession and intestate succession, and in testamentary succession, we are narrowed down to unprivileged wills. So this is the importance of dealing with wills is that you don't have the author around to make a comment on it, because the will is becomes or comes into forefront or dispute is raised only when the testator is no longer and the legatees would like to have a difference of opinion or challenging the will. We have a plethora of decisions which would say that the testator, it should be ensured that the mind followed the pen, so that the execution of the will is proper, and it has to be established. And sanctity is attributed to the will because it's the final wish of the testator. Equally strict are the rules of evidence to make sure that there is no misuse or there is any miscarriage of justice. And often the Supreme Court has said that you should put yourself in the armchair of the testator to know or, I mean, think about what exactly went in the mind. And just because he has disinherited a son or daughter, that just by itself does not mean that it is not his will. I mean, there are different nuances. We'll be touching upon the most important ones today, and we have the best person to talk about it, Justice V. Ram Kumar, sir. So I don't want to take your time, sir. Over to you directly.
Thank you, Mr. Shyam Padman. Good evening, friends. A confirmed criminal is hereby attempting to become civilized. How far he will succeed is for you to judge. In this lecture, we are concerned only with the unprivileged wills, and that too with regard to execution. In the lecture tomorrow, we will deal with the aspect of mode of proof, how to prove a will. Here, how to execute a will today. What is the distinction between privileged will and unprivileged will? Many of you, or at least non-lawyers, may not be knowing. A privileged will is one executed by a person who is a soldier employed in an expedition, or a soldier engaged in actual warfare, or an airman employed in an expedition, or an airman again engaged in actual warfare, or a mariner at sea. These are the five categories of persons who can execute a privileged will, because they are privileged by virtue of the function, by virtue of the service they render at the war front or etc. in places like that. So you can't expect the usual modalities of executing a will. But we are not concerned about that category of will today, because the majority of the population is concerned with the unprivileged will, that is will executed by persons who are not so privileged. Section 65 to 67 and 72 of the Indian Succession Act 1925 deal with privileged wills. So we won't be dealing with those four sections. An unprivileged will is one executed by a person other than one belonging to the above categories: soldier, airman, etc., engaged in actual warfare or in an expedition, or a mariner at sea. Where a person called the testator executes a will before his death with regard to his property, then upon his death, as Mr. Shyam mentioned, the properties will not devolve as per his personal law of succession or inheritance governing him, but instead of the personal law, his inheritance will be decided by the prescription in the will executed by him. That is what we call testamentary succession. Now shall we go to the questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Can I take the first question, sir?
Yes.
What is meant by testamentary succession?
As I already mentioned, testamentary succession is the succession or devolution of properties of a dead person as per the prescriptions under a will executed by such person. Such person is called a testator, and the document which he executes is usually called a will and testament. Good. We go to question number two.
Yeah. So what is the law which governs testamentary succession in India?
In India, the law which governs testamentary succession is the Indian Succession Act 1925, a pre-constitutional law. Even now, it governs all Indians. Yes.
Which and, part of the Indian Succession Act would be a corollary to that question?
Part 6 of Indian Succession Act deals with testamentary succession. All other parts do not deal with testamentary succession. This is the part 6 of the Indian Succession Act dealing with testamentary succession. There are altogether 23 chapters from chapters 1 to 23 in part number 6, which covers sections 57 to 191 of the Indian Succession Act. All are covered by part 6 of the Indian Succession Act, testamentary succession. Yes. Question 4.
So 3.
Three is dead.
Okay. What is the meaning of will under the Indian Succession Act 1925?
See, Indian Succession Act defines the expression will under section 2H of the Act. A will is defined as follows. Will means the legal declaration of the intention of a testator with respect to his property, which he desires to be carried into effect after his death. So a will, even though he is executing a will with regard to his properties, to how they should be dealt with after his death, the will actually takes effect only from the date of death of the testator. Then section 3, clause 64 of the General Clauses Act 1897 also defines a will as follows. Will shall include a codicil and every writing making a voluntary posthumous disposition of property. Posthumous disposition. That is, the property is disposed of after his death. So it is called posthumous disposition of property. Now the word will is the translation of the Latin word voluntas, which was the term used in the text of Roman law to express the intention of the testator. Voluntas means the intention of the testator. You may refer to an important decision of the Supreme Court in paragraph 10 of Uma Devi Nambiar versus T.C. Sidhan. 2004, volume 2, SEC 321, corresponding to AIR 2004 Supreme Court 1772.
And in fact, we conducted the case before the courts below until it went up to the Supreme Court. Dr. Sidhan's wife.
Yes. Question number 5.
Sir, whenever somebody writes their will, you say it is testamentary succession. So is there any distinction between will and a testament?
Yes, there is a distinction. A will is usually called along with the testament. As you rightly said, will and testament. This is the last will and testament of so-and-so, such and such person. Why do you call it a will and testament? Now, it is an instrument made in contemplation of death. Therefore, a will is a testamentary disposition of a person real property. Real property means land and other immovable property. And a testament is an instrument for disposal of his personal property. In law, we all know real property is immovable property and personal property is movable property. So movables and intangible properties are taken in by testament. So when you say will and testament, it takes in both immovable and movable properties. So when and the person who executes that document is called the testator. Yes, question number 6.
What is the code, sir?
Yes. Section 2B of the Indian Succession Act 1925 defines a codicil as follows. Codicil means an instrument made in relation to a will and explaining, altering, or adding to its dispositions and shall be deemed to form part of the will. That is the definition of codicil under Section 2B of the Indian Succession Act. In fact, codicil is like any other will. It is also, it has to be executed with all the formalities of executing a will. In fact, the Supreme Court in Bhagat Ram versus Suresh, AR 2004 Supreme Court 436, AR 2004 Supreme Court 436 has observed that a codicil for its validity must be executed and attested in the same manner as a will. So codicil is nothing but a will only. Maybe very often it is executed after the execution of a will or at the end of a will. Therefore, codicil may be a separate document, but it has to be executed with all the requisites of essentials of a valid will, executing a valid will. Question number 7.
Codicil cannot exist on its own. It should be attached to a will.
Not necessarily. It can refer to the will. It can refer to the will already executed. It can, because as the definition goes, explaining, because as you rightly said, it presupposes the existence of a will. Explaining, altering, or adding to the dispositions under a will is a codicil. But if you want to, for example, a testator might have forgotten a particular aspect in the will. Therefore, he may execute a codicil for which also the formalities are the same. It can add to, explain, or alter the prescriptions in the will. That is called a codicil.
More or less like an addendum and an erratum.
Exactly. It contains everything. It can even effect an erratum.
Correct, sir. Now, the next question deals with Indian Muslims. Can they make an oral will of their immovable properties?
Now, if it is open to a Muslim to execute an oral will, this is because Section 58.1 of the Indian Succession Act declared that the provisions of Part 6 of the Indian Succession Act does not apply to testamentary succession to the property of Mohammedans. Therefore, in the case of Muslims, the law applicable to them in the matter of executing a will, which is called a wasiyat in their personal law, wasiyat is their personal, it is their personal law which governs them, not the Indian Succession Act. They are exempted from Part 6. While all others can execute only a written will, Muslims can execute an oral will. Likewise, a privileged will also can be an oral will because by virtue of the position they occupy at the war front, etc. Otherwise, all wills have to be, especially all unprivileged wills, has to be in writing. As per the personal law of the Muslims, a Muslim cannot bequeath more than 1/3 of the surplus of his estate after payment of the funeral expenses and debts. Any bequest made in excess of the legal 1/3 cannot take effect unless the legal heirs consent to the same after the death of the testator. This is the special provision in the Muslim law. Another important attribute of wasiyat is that it need not be in writing and can also be oral, as I already mentioned. Yes. Question 8.
Are not all the provisions, that is Section 57 to 191 of Part 6 of the Indian Succession Act 1925, applicable to Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains?
I already said that Part 6 contains Sections 57 to 191. But all these provisions are not applicable to one particular category of person, namely Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains. by virtue of Section 57 of the Indian Succession Act, only those provisions of Part 6, as are shown in Schedule 3, the Act contains a schedule, Schedule 3rd Schedule, only those provisions which are shown in the 3rd Schedule alone are, and that too subject to the restrictions and modifications specified in Schedule 3, alone are applicable to Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains. Yes, question number 9.
I think the next question is almost answered. Which sections of Part 6 of the Indian Succession Act 1925 are excluded in their application to Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains?
Yes, I will now refer to section by section which are excluded.
Yes. Yes.
Section 60 relating to testamentary guardian, they are excluded. Then section 65 to 67, I already told you, pertain to privileged wills. Again, section 72 is also relating to privileged wills. Then section 69, revocation of marriage of the testator. When the testator marries, it automatically revokes the will executed by him, earlier will executed by him. That is also not made applicable to Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains. Then section 91, a general bequest include any property within the power of the testator is excluded from these four categories of persons. Then section 92, where there is default in the direction for appointment, the objects in the will to operate as a gift, that provision also does not apply to these four categories. Again, section 93, effect of bequest to heirs, etc. of particular person without qualifying terms also does not apply to Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains. Then section 94, effect of bequest to representatives, etc. of a particular person, not applicable. 97, effect of words describing a class added to the bequest in favor of a person. When you mention about a class to a person, that is not applicable to these four categories. Then section 99, mentioning meaning of specified relations referred to in the will, meaning of specified relations, that's not applicable to Hindus, Buddhists and Sikhs and Jains. Section 100, relatives denote only legitimate relatives, failing which it will include the person who acquired the reputation of such relative, not applicable to these four categories. Then section 118, when does the power to exist to bequeath properties to religious or charitable uses? This section, even without excluding, has been struck down by the apex court in John Vallamettam versus Union of India, 2003, volume 6, SEC 611, 2003, volume 6, SEC 611, where it was held that it is violative of Articles 14, 15, 25 and 26 of the Constitution of India. And this provision was struck down by the Supreme Court way back in 2003. It was a case from Kerala. Then we pass on to question number 10.
Why is it said that except in the case of privileged wills, a Hindu, Buddhist, Sikh or Jain cannot execute an oral will?
That is because by virtue of restriction number 1, in Schedule 3 to the Indian Succession Act, the above persons cannot bequeath property which they cannot alienate inter vivos. See, all these categories under the Contract Act and Transfer Property Act, they cannot alienate properties orally inter vivos. Inter vivos meaning during their lifetime. During their lifetime, if they cannot alienate properties orally, they cannot execute a will also orally. That is because of the restriction number 1 in Schedule 3 of the Indian Succession Act. That is why just as an oral sale is not permissible, an oral will also is not permissible. One second. Kindly excuse me.
I'm
sorry. Yes.
So sometimes while discussing will, there is also a God will that one should have a break. Yes, sir.
Now so we pass on.
You were discussing that. 10th question you were discussing.
Yes. That I completed.
Yes.
Because of the restriction number one in Schedule 3, a person other than a Muslim or a person executing a privileged will, he cannot execute an oral will, because if he cannot execute a sale deed inter vivos, likewise he cannot execute an oral will also. Yes, question 11.
Question number 11 would be a bit difficult for me, but still I'll start. I think I'll share with Vikas also, in the sense like it's Latin maxims and yes.
Will and testament means that you have to learn some Latin maxims. At least 7 are being discussed here.
Like I started off saying, sir, Latin is Greek to me, but still I'll start.
Yes.
The first one is testatum est
testamentum.
Testamentum is voluntatis nostre gesta sententiae. Sententiae. De io corpus post mortem suam feri velit.
Yes, you by and large manage it.
Oh, thank you, sir.
It only means a testament is the just expression of our will concerning that which anyone wishes to be done after his death. Or a testament is the legal declaration of a man's intentions which he wishes to be performed after his death. This maxim gets statutory recognition in the definition of will under Section 2H of the Indian Succession Act. Then comes second. You leave something for Vikas also.
Thankfully, that Latin maxim is slightly shorter.
Yes.
Testamentum omni morte consummatum.
Consummatum. Every will is completed by the death of the testator. A will cannot take effect when the testator is still alive. It takes effect only from the date of death of the testator. Yes. Third
is voluntas facit quod in testamenta scriptum valet.
Yes, the intention of the testator gives validity to what is written in the will. This maxim gets statutory recognition in Section 87 of the Indian Succession Act, which says the testator's intention is to be effectuated as far as possible. In fact, we will come across a 1949 decision of the Bombay High Court speaking through Chief Justice M.C. Chagla, where this principle was given effect to, and in very many high courts, the same 49 Bombay is being followed, because when on some hyper technicality the court is about to say that the will is not properly executed, every endeavor shall be given to effectuate the intention of the testator. So here is a person who is not alive to say about the dispositions made by him. Therefore, the court, that is why the court is getting into the armchair of the testator and deciding the question. So every endeavor shall be made to effectuate the intention of the testator. Yes. Fourth.
Voluntas testatoris habet
interpretum
it peniginum. I thought sir has given us a tongue twisters today.
The will of the testator should receive broad and liberal interpretation. Same principle. That is, again, you get statutory recognition of that principle in Section 87 of the Indian Succession Act. The intention of the testator should not be allowed to be defeated by the courts by a process of interpretation. Yes. Fifth.
Testatoris ultima voluntas est perimplenda secundum verum intentionem.
Intentionem suam.
Suam. Or voluntas ultima testatoris est perimplenta secundum verum intentionem suam.
Same principle. The last will of the testator is to be fulfilled according to his true intention. His true intention should be effectuated by every court trying to interpret a will, instead of finding out technicalities to defeat his intention. section. That is why I said in year 1949 Bombay, Justice Chief Justice Chagla, Chagla and I think it is Gajendra Gadkar, both these judges, great judges, they have evolved a principle, giving effect to these principles by saying that if on some technicality, the job of the court is not to strike down the will as not validly executed. Every endeavor should be done to see that the intention of the testator is fulfilled by the courts. Because he is not alive to explain his will. Therefore, court is stepping into his shoes and trying to interpret, trying to gauge his intention, his mind. Yes.
Yeah. Voluntas testatoris.
Ambulatoria. Ambulatoria.
Est usque ad modern or yes. Voluntas testatoris est ambulatoria osc ad extrem vitae extrem. Sir, after reading all these maxims, I'm feeling that they say that the lawyer should speak with a pause. After speaking all these maxims, correct. I think his style of argument will automatically change.
Yes, it will get slowed down.
Shyam will concur with that.
It will get slowed down. No, it only means that the will of the testator is changeable right up to his death. Or the testator may change his will at any time. That is why it is always said that a will is ambulatory in character. Will is ambulatory in character because any time the testator can change his will. This maxim gets recognition in statutory recognition section 62 of the Indian Succession Act. Yes.
Ambulatoria and ambulance, do they have some connotations simultaneously?
Ambulatoria means it is liable to change. It goes on changing. It is liable to change. He can always change it until his last breath. Until his last breath, he can go on changing. Supposing
it is not static. It is not static. It can change.
Exactly. That is why even in the same will, if an earlier, there are two conflicting clauses, mutually conflicting clauses. Unlike in the case of ordinary instruments, ordinary deeds, the principle of interpretation is that the earlier conflicting clause will prevail and the latter conflicting clause will have to be rejected. But in the case of a will, there's a difference. The last one will prevail. When there are two conflicting clauses, one conflicting or one diametrically opposite to the other, the last conflicting clause will prevail. That is only that in wills alone, you will find this exception. In all other situations, the earlier clause will prevail. The last clause will be dismissed as false or demonstrative. Demonstrator, yes.
Last testamenta, testamenta cum duo inter se pugnatia.
Pugnatia. Pugnatia. Pugnatia means to fight. Pugnatia.
Reparinter. Ultimum ratum est or sic est cum duo inter se
pugnatia.
Pugnatia. Reparinter in iodum testamento.
When two conflicting wills are found, the last one will prevail. So as it is when two conflicting clauses in the will shall, when there are two conflicting clauses, the last clause will prevail. Supposing there are two wills, the last will prevail. Likewise, supposing there are two conflicting clauses in the same will, the last clause will prevail. This is an exception to the normal rule applicable to all deeds, all instruments. Where the earlier clause will prevail. But in the case of a will, the last clause will, because it is ambulatory in character, the testator can always change his intention, change his mind. So that is why these legal doctrines are recognized by courts. Yes. Now, over to the, about the tongue distress.
We'll go back to our
language. The way we were taking the Latin maxim, I'm reminded that one is going very smoothly, then they are speed breakers. They are so much jerk. Sometimes you feel whether they are the pitfalls or the pitfalls, or yes. They are the speed breakers. And I'm reminded in a lighter vein, so it would have its own expression in Punjabi once it said, these difficult word like this was coming time and again. It was a criminal case. The lawyer used to pronounce it in a different way and the judge he had a different slang of English, perfect pronunciation. Yes. He time and again used to say, you should pronounce properly. Yes. Ultimately, it was around 10 times when that word used to come. And he said, in Punjabi, he said, oh, fir aa gaya. It means it has again come.
You are incorrigible. Yes, question
to... valid will.
Yes. Section 59 of the Indian Succession Act enumerate the persons who are capable of making a valid will. The said section reads, I will read the section, 59. Persons capable of making wills. Every person of sound mind, not being a minor, may dispose of his property by will. There are a few explanations. Explanation one, a married woman may dispose of by will any property which she could alienate by her own act during her life. Then explanation two, persons who are deaf and dumb or blind are not thereby incapacitated for making a will if they are able to know what they are doing. Then third explanation, a person who is ordinarily insane may make a will during interval in which he is of sound mind. That is why we very often we say during the lucid intervals, an unsound mind during its lucid intervals can make a will. As in the case of committing crimes also. If he commits a crime during his lucid interval, he won't get the protection of Section 84 of the Indian Penal Code. Then, explanation 4. No person can make a will while he is in such a state of mind, whether arising from intoxication or from illness or from any other cause, that he does not know what he is doing. There are a few illustrations given. First illustration is, A can perceive what is going on in his immediate neighborhood and can answer familiar questions, but has not a competent understanding as to the nature of his property or the persons who are kindred to him or in whose favor it would be proper that he should make a will. A cannot make a valid will. He is incapable of making a just assessment of his property, etc., and to whom he should bequeath his property. A executes an instrument purporting to be his will, but he does not understand the nature of the instrument nor the effect of its provisions. This instrument is not a valid will. So he is incapable of understanding the implications of the document. A being very feeble and debilitated, but capable of exercising a judgment as to the proper mode of disposing of his property, makes a will. This is a valid will, notwithstanding his debility. Therefore, what do you call a person who is not of sound mind? A person who is not of sound mind is usually called non-compos mentis. Non-compos mentis means a person who is not of sound mind. Yes. Question 13
is of practical value in the sense like the points to be borne in mind before proceeding to make a will.
Yes, you are absolutely right. When a person is about to make a will, he will call the scribe or he will go to the scribe and he will have some relation with him who is a dependable person. And what all things which should enter the mind of a scribe or a document writer while preparing a will? This is the answer. One, every person, whether male or female, and who is of age of majority, capable of making a will, as per Section 59 of the Indian Succession Act, which I refer to now, can make a will. That is a fundamental principle. Then, a will should be in writing. Of course, a privileged will by its very nature need not be in writing. Similarly, a will by a Muslim can be oral. But it is, even in the case of a Muslim, it is safer to make a valid will, a written will. Then, third is, it is desirable to ascertain the name, description, identity, and geographical location of the movable and immovable properties owned by the testator. He should have a fair idea about the movable and immovable properties which is owned by him. Then, the details of the specific properties, if any, which the testator desires to dispose of during his lifetime to specific persons, if any, otherwise than the proposed will, may be ascertained. Now, apart from giving properties to the legatees, which he is proposing to bequeath, he may be desirous of alienating properties to certain persons during his lifetime. Other than through the will. Though he should be aware of those properties also, specific items of properties, which he does not want to bequeath as per a will. That also he should have. Then the name, description, identity, and geographical location of the specific properties and the specific person to whom testator desires to bequeath his assets with the and relationship, if any, of such persons with the testator. These are also to be ascertained, because which all properties he wishes to bequeath to which all persons, what is his relationship with those persons, all these things should be ascertained so that the appropriate instructions can be given to the scribe, to the document writer, while preparing the will. If in case he is engaging a document writer, no need at all to have a document writer for writing a will. You can write a will in your own handwriting on a piece of paper. No stamp duty is payable. No registration is necessary. It need not be registered. Registration is only optional. So you can write down your will in a piece of paper. Only thing is the requirements of law should be satisfied, namely the execution and attestation. That's all. Otherwise, a will written in your own handwriting, manuscript will, is called a holograph will. Then if the movable, immovable properties of the testator are in one country and the testator in another country, where his movables and some immovables are to be found, it is advisable that he executes two separate wills, one relating to his properties in the country of his domicile and another relating to his property where situated abroad. So it is desirable to have two separate wills instead of clubbing all these properties in one single instrument. Then the personal law by which the testator is governed may be ascertained. The language of the will can be the language usually spoken and understood by the testator. Very often when we attack a will, we very often find the language of the document writer, the scribe, which may not be the language of the testator. So it is very often argued while attacking a will, this was not the language of the testator. He was using very simple vernacular language. He never used such a technical expression. So it is not his will. That is one way of attack. So ordinarily it is his language to be adopted. The will can be drawn upon any ordinary paper. No stamp duty is payable in respect of will. The rules regarding execution and attestation should be scrupulously followed. That is the only requirement for a valid will. Registration of the will is not compulsory, but is only optional. Even if the will is admitted or disputed or denied or called in question by the opposite party, the propounder will have to prove two things. One, the propounder means the person who sets up the will. He will have to prove two things. The testamentary capacity of the testator. That is, the testator was in a sound disposing state of mind. Then the execution and attestation of the will, due execution and attestation of the will. This also will have to be proved by every propounder who sets up a will or who claims properties under a will. We pass on to question number 14.
Is there any distinction in the matter of mode of proof as between will and other documents required by law to be tested?
Yes. It's an important question. There is a distinction. An important distinction in the matter of mode of proof between a will and other documents required by law to be attested should be borne in mind by every person. As per Section 68 of the Indian Evidence Act, every compulsorily attestable document, including a will, can be used in evidence. Can be used in evidence only if one attesting witness, at least, has been called for the purpose of proving its execution. If there be an attesting witness alive and subject to the process of the court and capable of giving evidence. But the proviso to Section 68 contains a relaxation to the above rule in the case of all compulsorily attestable document other than a will. So in the case of a will, no relaxation at all. But in the case of all other compulsorily attestable document, the document is registered, There's a relaxation in the proviso to Section 68. If such a compulsorily attestable document has been registered as per the provisions of the Registration Act 1908, then the main part of Section 68 need not be complied with, namely calling at least one attesting witness. But in the case of a will, there is absolutely no relaxation. The requirements of main part of section 68 of the Evidence Act will have to be scrupulously followed in the case of a will, because there is the executant is not alive to confirm or deny the document. So that is why the law is very strict. Then question 15.
Sir, we earlier dealt with what is to be borne in mind when proceeding to make a will. Now, during the process of making the will, a valid execution, how it can be ensured in an unprivileged, what is the legal mandates for that?
Yes. Now, Section 63 of the Indian Succession Act is the section for proving due execution of a will. Now, in fact, in the case of other documents or other instruments, which are compulsorily attestable, execution is different from attestation. In the case of all other documents, execution is different from attestation. The signing of the document is mainly the execution. But in the case of a will, even attestation is included in the expression execution. See, the title of Section 63 itself, Execution of Unprivileged Wills, that takes in attestation also. Unlike other instruments, every testator, not being a soldier employed in an expedition or engaged in actual warfare, or they are excluding the privileged will, or engaged in an actual warfare, or an airman so engaged or employed, or a mariner at sea, shall execute his will. Every testator shall execute his will according to the following rules. Clause A. The testator shall sign or shall affix his mark to the will or shall be signed by some other person in his presence and by his direction. That is signing of the will, either by the testator or by some other person on his direction. Then the signature or mark of the testator or the signature of the person signing for him shall be so placed that it shall appear that it was intended thereby to give effect to the writing as a will. The signature should not appear in some corner of the paper. It should show the placement, the position of the signature or mark should be such that it should appear that it was intended to be put as an in acceptance or acknowledgement of the prescriptions under the will. So it should be even the location of the signature, placement of the signature has got some importance. Then C. The will should be attested by two or more witnesses who has seen the testator sign or affix his mark to the will or has seen some other person sign the will in the presence and by the direction of the testator or has received from the testator a personal acknowledgement of his or the signature of such other person, and each of the witnesses shall sign the will in the presence of the testator. But it shall not be necessary that more than one witness be present at the same time, and no particular form of attestation shall be necessary. Now, the testator has put his signature or mark as contemplated by Section 63A of the Act only after the contents of the writing have been containing his intention regarding devolution, etc., have been explained to him or understood by him. This is because it is not possible to authenticate the declaration before it has actually been reduced to writing. Something which is non-existent cannot obviously be authenticated. You may refer to a few decisions on this aspect. AIR 1985 Allahabad 220. AIR 1986 Allahabad 220. Then AIR 1974 Andhra Pradesh 13. They are all beautiful discussions, contain beautiful discussions regarding the why such a strict prescriptions have been made. Then AIR 1974 Andhra Pradesh page 13, AIR 1982 Calcutta 236. Then regarding the position of the signature or the mark of the testator should be so placed that it should appear that it was intended thereby to give effect to the document, to the instrument, as a will. That is, Yamnam Ongvi Thamba Ibema Devi. That is 2009, volume 4, SEC 780. 2009, volume 4, SEC 780. Three judges of the Supreme Court have applied their mind to this aspect of the execution. The signature or mark should find in such a place. It should be so placed that it should appear that it was done with the necessary intention of executing a will, not at some remote corner of the paper. The propounded will was not accepted as duly executed will in these cases. In these cases, the propounded will was not accepted because the signature was not found at the appropriate location, place, situs where it should have been there. AR 2020, NOC 456, Kerala, corresponding to 2020, KHC 3372. Then there's a Madras decision, Muthulakshmi versus Thangaraj, 2020, KHC 3335, corresponding to AR 2020, NOC 417, Madras. 417, Madras. In these decisions, since the signatures were not, or the marks were not found at the appropriate situs, the court did refuse to accept the document as a valid will, because anything can be fabricated as a will, because that person is not alive to confirm or deny. That is why the courts apply these strict rules. Question 60.
Yeah. On the request and direction of the testator, his nephew affixes his mark to the will at the appropriate place where the testator should sign. There are two attestators also to the will. In a suit for partition, the will is propounded by the legatee. One of the testators give evidence in support of what transpired in the making of the will. The opposite party argues that there is no due execution of the will. Can the opposite party succeed?
What happened? We have seen the definition. We have seen section 63. Now, on the request and direction of the testator level, his nephew affixes his mark to the will at the appropriate place where the testator ought to have signed. There are two also. In a suit for partition, the will propounded by the legatee, one of the attestors gives evidence regarding what in support of what transpired in the making of the will. The opposite party argues that there is no due execution of the will. What have you got to say? We have read the definition. Now, can you please screen share that chart which I have given you, and given you a chart? In fact, one important aspect in the definition has been omitted here, or there's a mistake committed by the either the scribe or by the testator himself. Because testator can sign the document. Testator can put a mark instead of signature. But if somebody else is asking somebody else, he can only ask that somebody else to sign. That somebody else cannot put a mark. See the chart I have given. I have the section 63 has been dissected. I have dissected section 63 to make it more understandable. Section 63 has been bisected into its component parts, so that if you can screen share that.
Yes. I sharing.
Yes. See, now please go through the. Execution of an unprivileged will, section 63. The testator shall sign the will, clause A. The signature of the testator shall be so placed and that it shall appear that it was intended thereby to give effect to the writing as a will. That is clause B. Or the testator shall affix his mark to the will. Instead of signing, he can affix his mark to the will, clause A. That the mark of the testator shall be so placed that it shall appear that it was intended thereby to give effect to the writing as a will, clause B. So he can either sign the will at the appropriate place, or he can put a mark in the will at the appropriate place. Both are execution, part of execution. Or the will shall be signed by some other person and by the direction of the testator. Instead of the testator himself signing or putting his mark, he can ask some other person to sign the will. Only to sign the will, mind you. That some other person cannot put a mark. That prerogative is available only to the testator. Therefore, when the testator asks somebody else to sign the will, and if that other person puts a mark, it is not valid execution. That is precisely what happened in our problem. So that person put a mark instead of signing. That is, see the next portion. The will shall be signed by some other person, by the direction of the testator, clause A. The signature of the person signing for the testator shall be so placed that it shall appear that it was intended thereby to give effect to the writing as a will. Then the will shall be, now coming to the attestation, the will shall be attested by two or more witnesses called the testator or attesting attestors, each of whom has seen the testator sign. Each of the attestors should see that the testator has signed or seen the testator affix his mark. Instead of signing, each of them should see the testator affixing his mark or has seen some other person sign the will. See, in the case of some other person, putting mark is not given. The right to put mark is not given. He can only sign. Some other person signed the will in the presence and direction of the testator or received from the testator personal acknowledgement, etc. So this is a case where the other person who was requested by the testator to sign the will, he, instead of signing the will, he put his mark. So that is not valid execution. Then I will put one question out of the box, which is not there. In the presence and direction of the testator, his brother-in-law, that is wife's brother, put the signature for and on behalf of the testator at the appropriate place. One of the attestors present signed as such in the presence of the testator. The brother-in-law of the testator took the will to the owner of the next door apartment, and on his request and acknowledgement, that will was signed by the owner of the apartment. See, this is the problem. Testator signed the will. One attestor was present along with the testator. He also signed the will because he has seen the testator signing the will. Then that attestor took the will document to the next door apartment, and he told the owner that this is the will executed by so and so. I have put my signature as the first attestor. You are requested to put your signature as the second attestor. He reads out the prescriptions under the will also. That person is convinced that it is valid will executed by the next door man. So he puts his signature. Is there any impropriety in such an execution? Please look into the chart.
The testator has to say that otherwise it's not valid.
The testator received from the testator a personal acknowledgement. The personal acknowledgement that it is my will, I have executed it, this is my signature. That acknowledgement should come from the testator, not from the one of the attestors. So to that extent, the attestation is bad. So every care should be taken that this other person who is requested to sign as the testator, on behalf of the testator, should sign. He cannot put his mark. Likewise, the personal acknowledgement to an attestor who has not seen the testator signing should be from the testator himself. Rather, the testator should himself go to the next door apartment and tell him, see, this is my will. I executed this. These are the prescriptions under the will. These are the bequests. Such and such property being bequeath to my nephew, etc. Then he should say that this is my signature. I have signed it. Now you as an attester may sign. Yeah, one of the other attesters have signed it. Not for any of the attesters to tell another attester that testator signed. I have seen it. No, testator himself should make the acknowledgement. That is the beauty of the section. Yes. Now we pass on to question 70.
Sir, in the other case you mentioned, Umadevi yes. Nambiar versus T.C. Siddhan.
Yes.
The first witness signed from Calicut.
Yes.
The bill was taken to Ernakulam. The second attesting witness was Justice T.L. Vishwanath Iyer.
Yes.
He signed from Ernakulam, not at the same yes. place. But yes. Testator, who is the wife of T.C. Siddhan, that is yes. Rani Siddhan, said yes. that it's my signature.
Yes. Now see the last portion of this section in the chart also.
Right.
Last portion. It shall not be necessary that more than one witness be present at the yes. same time.
Absolutely.
At the same time. And no particular form of attestation shall be necessary. I'll be taking you through a few decisions, including 1949 Bombay, where the attester who was examined failed to prove that he had seen the other attester signing. On that short ground, the matter, of course, they did not say that the willis has not been validly proved. They remanded the matter because of the other principle of section 87, that the intention of the testator should not be allowed to be defeated by the court. Therefore, as a court of conscience, they allowed the propounder to prove due execution. But I have my own reservations about that part of the of 1949 Bombay, as well as all other rulings which say that one of the attesters should see that other attester signing. That is doing violence to the section. Section says it shall not be necessary that more than one witness be present at the same time. What does it mean? Yes. Now we will pass on to question number 70.
What is meant by animo attestandi?
The Latin expression very often we come across in this jurisdiction is onus probandi and animo attestandi. Onus probandi is the burden of proof which is on the propounder of the will. He has to prove that the will was executed, duly executed by a testator having the requisite state of mind. And there was due execution of the will. That is the onus probandi which is on the propounder. The burden of proof on the propounder. Then animo attestandi. Animo attestandi is the animus in the attester to the will. The person who attesting the will should sign the document with the intention of attesting the will. That is animo, intention, animo. He should sign the will animo attestandi, means he should sign the will with the requisite intention that and knowledge and understanding that he is attesting a very solemn document, namely execution of a will. That is the meaning of animo attestandi. Then you may refer to one decision, M.L. Abdul Jabbar Sahib versus M.V. Venkata Shastri, 1969, volume 1 SEC 573. 1969, volume 1 SEC 573. A three judges bench. It was observed that it is essential that the witness should have put his signature animo attestandi. That is for the purpose of attesting that he has seen the executant sign or has received from him a personal acknowledgement of his signature. He should see the testator either sign the document or he should receive a personal acknowledgement from the testator that I have signed the will. This is my signature. You can now put your signature as an attester. Then only you can say that he has attested the will animo attestandi with the intention or with the knowledge and intention of attesting the document. The document as question 18.
So what is meant by attestation?
Yes, that is another important aspect of section 63. Attestation means to testify or affirm to be true or genuine or authenticate the execution of the document or instrument by the executant by signing as a will. This is called attestation. In Babu Singh versus Ram Sahai, alias Ram Singh, 2008, volume 14, SEC 754, corresponding to AIR 2008 Supreme Court 2485. AIR 2008 Supreme Court 2485. It has been held that attestation of a will should be in conformity with Section 3 of the Transfer of Property Act 1882. With due respect, I have my own reservations about these observations. Attestation, the requirement of attestation is in Section 63 itself. Why do you go to Transfer of Property Act? Section 3 of the Transfer of Property Act. There also the word at Section 3 of the Transfer of DP Act also defines attestation the same meaning, same words which you occur in Clause 3, Clause C. Clause C of Section 63 of the Indian Succession Act. Same meaning, same words. And when the same words are occurring in 63 itself, why should you go to DP Act? DP Act is for a document, for a transfer, document of transfer. This is not a document of transfer, is not. This is not a transfer inter vivos. This is, you are executing a will to take effect after the death of the testator. So you can't call it a transfer. How does the Transfer of Property Act come in picture? I have my own reservations with due respect, subject to any one of you elucidating me or enlightening me. That decision says the will should satisfy the, it should be in conformity with the expression attested occurring in Section 3 of the DP Act, which contains the same wording as in Clause C of Section 63. Attested in relation to an instrument. Same wording are formed. Therefore, in my respectful submission, that decision should not apply to a will which is not a transfer inter vivos. Transfer of property act applies only to documents of transfer. Will is not a document of transfer. It is a document which the testator desires to come into effect only after his death. And that is, with that, I think I will close on the question of execution. Now, execution includes attestation also. You need not go to DP Act for proving attestation. Attestation is given in Clause C of Section 63. Now, next lecture tomorrow, how to prove a will. It is enough. It is not enough that a will has been duly executed. How to prove when a will and testament is put forward or is propounded by a person, maybe a legatee. How should he prove that will? How can the will be said to have been properly proved before a court of law? That is the next lecture. We will have it on tomorrow.
Yes. Same time.
4:30.
Yeah. A couple of questions are there in the chat box. Oh, yes. Can we take that? Murali has put a question. What do you mean by mark? Putting a mark other than signature.
That is what this is.
Any mark, X or anything.
Any mark or a square or a rectangle or a triangle. Or supposing a person is in the habit of putting a mark only. That mark is enough. But if the person who has been requested by the testator to put to sign the document.
He
has to put his signature. Supposing his signature is writing Sri. Supposing his signature is writing Sri, which may resemble a mark. That is his signature. But other than a signature, he cannot put a mark, which is the prerogative of the testator only.
Because, Amrita has put a question. Is it possible for one person to write a will for another?
Oh, yeah, nothing wrong. Any person can write. A scribe is writing. Very often, they go to a scribe for preparing a will. They are not familiar with the usual phraseology. Therefore, they very often go. But actually, it is not necessary. Going by the Indian Succession Act, you give expression to your intention by writing your desire, your intention in a piece of paper. That is enough if it conforms to the requirement of a will. And only thing is, it should be duly executed. The execution part should be is very strict, because especially in the case of unregistered wills, very often after the death of a person, people fabricate documents to be the last will of a person. So very often, that is why courts are very strict. But at the same time, if the court is satisfied that this is a testament, will and testament executed by a deceased person, and it should, and some hyper technicality is put forward, court should not be an instrument to that. Court should see that the intention of the testator is not defeated by such a hyper technicality.
Sir, Basava Rajeshwari has put a question that's regarding, sir, your statement that registration is optional. What if first will is registered and the second will is not?
No problem.
Registration does not give any separate sanctity.
Nothing, no particular sanctity. Section 17 of the Registration Act does not, 17.1 does not make it a compulsory. It is not a compulsorily registrable document. Unlike sale deed or other things of value above 100 rupees, it is compulsorily registrable. But in the case of a will, it falls under 17B or so, where it is optional. If he wants, he can register the will. That's all.
I think the confusion might have been created because there is a legal this thing, that is, a registered document can only be got over by another registered document by a declaration by a court of law.
That's why we, because in the case of a will, it is ambulatory, liable to be changed at any time. The testator can change it at any time before his death. So that is the basic quality of a will. Therefore, he should be able to change the prescriptions under a will at any time. He can even execute a codicil. The only thing is, codicil also should be executed as per the requirements of executing a will. That's all. Execution, attestation, execution.
Correct. Over to you, Vikas.
Can the content be general or has to be necessarily be specific in respect of properties? This is by Deshmukh.
If they are capable of identifying, if the description of the properties are so described, that it is possible to, or capable of identity, capable of being identified, that is enough.
This is by Advocate Kanan. By way of will, whether a testator can give ancestral properties to the propounder?
Ancestral?
Property be given to the propounder.
Yes, if the ancestral property, you mean undivided property? Ancestral property can be divided. And is it obtained from the ancestors, divided, or in joint family property? If it is joint family property, he has got a particular fraction. That fraction, that will operate only so far as his right over the property is concerned. Sharer, co-sharer. A co-sharer can execute a will with regard to his fraction of the property. That will.
If we can put it very simply, if you
got clarified, right, it's a joint family property.
Pardon?
He has clarified it's a joint family property.
Joint family property. Supposing he has got 1/5 share. Supposing he executes a will with regard to half of the entire property. That will take effect only with regard to his 1/3. He cannot usurp his rights over the entire property or a chunk of the property. It will take effect only so far as his right of the property is concerned. That is my understanding of the law, because I am not an expert on this branch of law. Please correct me if I am wrong.
Today you didn't start the session with a caveat. That's why people are asking more questions.
That is because some of my friends say that I am I am being re-civilized. Initially, I was a civil lawyer. Then,
old wine in a new bottle.
Maybe, whatever expression you call it.
What is the effect of the will not being probated?
That we'll come tomorrow.
Okay.
In fact, probate is not our subject in these two lectures. Issuing probate is not our subject. Probate, letters of administration, all these things are not in our subject, because we are only concerned with the execution and proof of a will, of an unprivileged will. Execution and proof only. Probate is something else. There are section 212 is there, where without taking probate, a rights under the will cannot be claimed by a person. Then supposing there is a debt due to a dead person, letters of succession certificate will have to be applied for. All those things we are not dealing in today or tomorrow, even tomorrow also.
This is on the YouTube. It says, can a minor be a witness to a will?
I doubt. Minor should be. Nothing wrong. Minor can be a witness. Because minor can be a witness before a court of law. If a minor can be a witness before a court of law under section 118 of the Evidence Act, even a minor is a competent witness. Therefore, if a minor can be a competent witness before a court of law, why not a minor be a witness to a will? I don't know. But witness in what sense? Attesting witness. Is it attesting witness or identifying witness? There are two types of witness to a will. One is attesting witness. Then at the time of registration, there will be an identifying witness. We will examine that tomorrow. That is, whether registration can prove valid execution of a will. Whether the execution before the sub-registrar who registers a will, whether that can prove valid execution of a will. That is one question on which we have different viewpoints by the Supreme Court and other high courts. A minority view is that even sub-registrar can prove valid execution. But the preponderance of judicial opinion is otherwise. Sub-registrar is there only to register the document. He cannot validly prove attest. He cannot attest the document. He is not an attesting witness. Of course, when before registration, he will ask the executor, the testator, whether this is a document, it is a will executed by you. He will say yes. But from that, you can't say that he is attesting the signature of the executant, etc. After getting an acknowledgement about his signature. But there is one or two decisions of the Supreme Court also to that effect. In fact, in one case, both the attesting witnesses were not alike. So, naturally, the court was inclined to accept the registrar's endorsement. As per the Registration Act, the sub-registrar has to make certain endorsement on the document. He had made endorsement that the testator admitted execution before me. And there are two witnesses signing. He also signs. But those two witnesses are signing as identifying. They sign before the sub-registrar as a person who has identified the testator. They are not attesting the testator's will, the will executed by the testator. But when the testator admits before the sub-registrar that this is my duly executed will executed by me, he is admitting execution. And if the sub-registrar, after getting an acknowledgement from the testator, signs it, he can loosely be called an attester. But then, which will should be attested at least by two attesters. Requirement of law is that there should be two attesters at least. Attestation, there should be two. For proving it, only one alone need be there. For proving attestation. But for attesting, there should be two or more, is what section says. So, registrar by himself cannot be two or more. And other two persons who are signing, they are only saying that this is the so-called person who admits execution of the will before you. We identify him as so and so. They are identifying the attester. They are not executing the will or attesting the execution of the will. To that extent, it may not be correct also. But anyway, faced with the difficulty of the attesting witnesses not being alive, Supreme Court had to rely on that.
This is, can there be three witnesses or only two are sufficient?
Two, minimum two. Two or more, that is what the section says. Section says two or more. Therefore, there should be minimum two. But while proving the will, due execution of the will, section 68 of the Evidence Act says only one attesting witness should be examined, if alive.
There's a last question by Ajit Sejwani. What are the consequences of a will when the testator signs a will when he's in ICU of the hospital. This question normally has arisen after the COVID.
Yes, if it can be shown by the propounder that the testator, with the full knowledge that he is executing a will, had signed the will, and if he is able to examine the doctor, etc., or the nurse who was attending on the testator, and he was having a requisite testamentary capacity, he was having the requisite testamentary capacity, that is, he was not in a morbid condition. He was not so morbid that his faculties were impaired. If that could be proved by the doctor or the nurse, then nothing wrong. If he knowingly and willingly put his signature or put his mark to the document, or requested a person, another person standing by him, to put his signature, even that is valid execution as per section 63. Only thing is, he should do that with the full knowledge that he is executing a solemn document in the form of a will and testament. If that can be proved, nothing wrong.
What happens if the testator turns hostile while giving evidence?
Testator will not turn hostile, because will takes effect only after his death. He will have to turn hostile from the other world.
not testator, attester.
You said attester. Attester turns hostile, then section 154 is there under the Evidence Act. Section 154, the person who called him as a witness can take the permit of the court to put questions which might be put in cross-examination by the opposite party, namely virtually cross-examining him. After taking the permission of the court, he can be cross-examined. Or if the other witness is alive, that is precisely what Bombay High Court did through M.C. Chagla. They found that...
The page number somebody is asking, that M.C. Chagla, 1949 Supreme Court.
49 Supreme Court, I gave you the page number 49. One second. I think it is 286 or so.
Right, so tomorrow we'll share it.
One second. Let me, right now. No problem. That is, every lawyer, every judge should know this decision. Because on hyper-technicalities, the intention of a testator should not be allowed to be defeated by such a... the court has got a responsibility in the matter. That is why we come to the armchair rule, etc. The court has to place itself in the position of a testator who is brooding in an armchair. I think it is 286 or so, page number. I had noted down somewhere.
Tomorrow we'll share it.
Okay.
This is, a Muslim is married under the Special Marriage Act, can still be governed by Muslim personal law, allowing them to execute a oral will or no?
He is a Muslim. See, marriage under the Special Law, Special Marriage Act will not make him a non-Muslim. He does not convert to a non, become a, it is because both the parties to the marriage are not the same religion. That is why Special Marriage Act is giving a right to get married. Just because they get married, they don't renounce their personal religion. A Muslim marrying a Hindu can marry under the Special Marriage Act, so that marriage can be validly registered. And he does not cease to be a Muslim. The other person also will not cease to be a Hindu. They don't indulge in apostasy, or the religion, they don't lose their religion by getting married under the Special Marriage Act. Because personal law will not allow a person outside the religion to have a marriage. That is why, whether it is Muslim or Hindu.
Yes, sir. So, these are all the questions which we had been discussing. And tomorrow, friends, we will connect again at 4:30 p.m. and to have the second part of the series, and it's always been a pleasure connecting with Justice Rao Kumar, because the way he takes things forward is a treat for the mind also, as well as the legal mind, it actually gets stimulated.
Thank you.
I'll ask Mr. Shyam again to conclude. Yeah, Mr. Shyam.
What else can I say? An evening or an afternoon well spent, and that too on the nuances of testamentary succession, unprivileged wills, whether it is criminal, whether it is civil, the inimitable style in which Ramkumar sir takes it, drills in, I mean, I'm sure that no doubts would be lingering in the minds, at least of how a will, if at all anyone among us want to have a will, each and everyone with example, in a question answer format, it has been drilled in. Indeed, indebted to you, sir, for I mean, the simple or simplification or demystification of the law, like, I mean, that's what is required, and that's the way we like to move forward. And because it's been wonderful that you've been carrying on this, and the way in which you're choosing the speakers, the topic, and the audience that is following you, it's really wonderful to be part of this. Thank you very much.
They all know. So I can only share that once we are taking with Littles together, they say that one is solo and two in a tango move things better. So once they know that Mr. Ramkumar and Mr. Shyam and Mr. Prem will come, the session will be stimulating to the mind.
Hopefully tomorrow, Prem and Mr. KVJ Rao will be there.
Absolutely. Yes, sir. We are missing the stars of today.
If there is a will, there is a way.
it is something different, sir. Wherever there is a will, there is a litigation.
I add to that, they say that where there is a will, there are lawyers, and lawyers also enjoy. Thank you, everyone. Stay blessed and stay safe.